We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
Hey everybody, it's Tracy Hamlin inviting you to join us this Monday, February 14th at 7 p.m. EST. We'll be joined by small business owner Brandon Ferris from Killer Bee Comics, as well as amazing trumpeteer and flugelhornist Rob Zinn. You do not want to miss this one. The Tracy Hamlin Show, presented by Our Music Channel on Our TV Network.
Are you ready on the Tracy Hamlin Show?
My funny Valentine, sweet comic Valentine, you make me smile with my heart. Your looks are laughable. Unphotographable. Yet you're my favorite work of art. Your figure, less than Greek, is your mouth just a tiny bit weak when you open it to speak? Are you smart? Are you smart? Don't change your hair for me. Not if you care for me. Stay, little Valentine. Stay. Because each day is Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day and welcome to the Tracy Hamlin Show. I'm an international recording artist and jazz festival owner, and I use music as a catalyst to give back to my community. And I can't wait to share more information with you guys about my upcoming jazz concerts, as well as the Tracy Hamlin Sweet Jazz and Wine Festival. My short song today was my version of Funny Valentine that I recorded on, it was back in the early 2000s with a jazz group by the name of Pieces of a Dream on their Love Silhouette CD. Check it out if you haven't already heard it. I'm so excited about the guests that we have today. As I always say on my show, in my travels and performances around the world, I have met and connected with some absolutely amazing folks. Some of them you may know, some of them may not yet be household names in mainstream artists, but they are extraordinary and you absolutely need to know about them. So today's show, we have amazing small business owner from Loudoun County, Virginia, and his name is Brandon Ferris from Killer Bee Comics. Please welcome Brandon to the show. Hello, Brandon. How are you?
Oh, amazingly well. Tracy, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. Good to see you again.
Well, thank you. Good to see you too. Thank you for joining us today. Well, we're going to dig right in because your resume is absolutely amazing. But I want to start with your service in the U.S. Air Force. First of all, thank you so much for your service. From your service, can you tell us one of the greatest things that you were able to learn about yourself?
Absolutely. I would have to say it was self-reliance, self-motivation, and self-regulation, so to speak. The military kind of teaches you, puts you in a situation where you have to follow orders, you have to adapt and adjust on the fly, you have to make sure that you're doing the best you can, because not only do you depend on yourself, those around you and the country that you serve depends on you. So I always wanted to make sure that my battle buddies, the men and women that came before me and those who came after me, had a strong example of what an airman could do.
Oh, I just love that. And thank you again for serving. I mean, just we love you guys that sacrifice so much for our freedom. So thank you. So Killer Bee Comics, tell us all about Killer. What is Killer Bee Comics?
So Killer Bee Comics is my business where I buy, sell, and consign comic books. I've been collecting comic books ever since I was 5 years old. They really were the first books that I read. So I wanted to take something that I was passionate about and create a business where I could engage people all around the country, all around the world, and share my passion for comic books. So very, very interesting. I really enjoy it.
I love that. So tell us, how did you get started with your company? Because I think that being an entrepreneur, it takes a lot of courage, and you have to be willing to step out on faith to follow your passion and take those risks. So what made you want to start this company? And tell us about that journey.
Yeah. So for me, I always knew I wanted something that was mine. So during the pandemic, you know, I have a day job, of course. While I was enjoying that, the pandemic gave me a lot of time to think, a lot of time to reflect and to look forward on the things that I wanted to do. So I knew that I wanted to create businesses that I was passionate about, right? So I'm passionate about serving people, helping them kind of advance themselves in their company, and I'm passionate about comic books. So I actually started two companies coming out of the pandemic, Killer Bee Comics, which I just talked about, and Quintessential Consulting, where I help small businesses achieve their goals in government contracting by helping them strategically plan, shape their way ahead to identify opportunities and help them win those contracts.
Oh, I think that is so necessary. And, you know, I've always said, and I saw a post during in the middle of the pandemic that, you know, having a side hustle used to be a luxury. Now it is a necessity. So kudos to you for just stepping out on faith, because, I mean, I think that I love that one is all about business and one is with, I mean, they're both with you following your passion. But I love the whole Killer Bee Comics concept. So with growing up reading comic books, who were some of your favorites?
My favorite, I mean, it would be cliche to say, you know, all the black superheroes, you know, but it really is, though. You know, growing up reading comic books, there weren't a lot of characters that looked like me. So when I saw characters like Luke Cage and Black Panther and Black Goliath, you know, I said, hey, look, those dudes kind of look like me. And, you know, they're from nations that haven't been conquered, like Wakanda. Or they're black men with indestructible skin like Luke Cage, you know, so it made me believe that, you know, the neighborhoods that I grew up in, that, you know, I could armor myself, I could outthink my competition, I could transform, I could find a way to leverage my strength to be more than what I am.
I love that. I absolutely love that. So you told us about who some of your favorite comics are. Who do you think some of the most popular are that may not be your favorite?
Even though, you know, I do support the African-American heroes, one of my all-time favorites is Spider-Man. So Spider-Man is still, you know, is one of the most popular characters, most recognized characters all over the world. So Spider-Man, Batman are really, you know, kind of in my favorites wheelhouse. But I'm also, you know, digging back into some of the lesser known heroes like I've been doing on my TikTok, exploring heroes like Icon and Rocket and, you know, learning more about Cyborg and, you know, Silhouette. So all of these, you know, second and third string characters have really become important. As you know, Marvel is doing a big thing with all of their TV shows and these superhero movies, where they've kind of exhausted all of the mainstream big names, Captain America, Hulk, Iron Man. These guys are, their stories have been told. So these second and third string characters are going to become more and more popular. So I'm very excited to kind of see where that journey goes.
Well, this is so interesting. It sounds like an amazing culture. We're going to take a short break, and we will be right back with more of Brandon Ferris and Killer Bee Comics. We'll be right back.
Hey everybody, I'm Tracy Hamlin, and I'm so excited to share that I'm going to be coming your way every Monday night for an entire hour to spotlight some phenomenal unsigned artists from around the globe, as well as some amazing small businesses from my area that you need to know about. I'm also going to throw in a song or two. Something like that, a little something like that. Now, I'm going to need you guys to tell all your friends, your cousins, your aunties, your bosses, come on in here and join us. We're going to have so much fun. You don't want to miss this. I'll see you soon. Ooches of smooches.
Are you ready?
Tracy Hamlin Show.
On the Tracy Hamlin Show.
Tracy Hamlin Show.
To the TV show Stargirl, Beth Chappell's Dr. Midnight has been getting some notice, but she debuted first in Infinity Inc. number 19 in December of 1985. She grew up in South Carolina, and she's a gifted gymnast, doctor, and surgeon, and is the protege of Dr. Charles Nider, the original Midnight. During a crisis on Infinite Earth, she was blinded by an oxygen bomb and developed perfect night vision, and like her mentor, she took over the mantle of Dr. Midnight.
Later, Beth died for a little while battling Eclipso, but thanks to the events of Doomsday Clock, she returned to life and reclaimed her mantle as Dr. Midnight. She also currently runs a clinic for superheroes and continues to Dr. Midnight all on her own. I mean, this is a character who's kind of been through it, developed an awesome power, developed her skill set, relied on everything she had to keep on doing it. Thanks for listening. Check me out on killerbeecomics.com, where the offer code Black History will save you 10% off your order.
Welcome back to the Tracy Hamlin Show. We are chatting it up with Brandon Ferris from Killer Bee Comics. So Brandon, we just saw a commercial where you featured for Black History Month. As a matter of fact, on your LinkedIn page for Black History Month, you have featured many comics of color. Can you tell us a little bit about one or two of them?
Yeah, I can.
So today's video was about the superhero known as Icon. Mm-hmm. So a small company called Milestone Comics was acquired by DC Comics, who owns Batman and Superman. And they bought the company and gave this all Black-owned, Black artist, Black writer, Black creators the opportunity to create their imprint, Milestone Comics. Mm-hmm. So Icon is their version of Superman. So he came from an alien planet. Unlike Superman, though, he landed in the Deep South in 1839. So the first person he encountered was a Black woman. So his alien DNA was programmed to allow him to mimic the first person he came in contact with. So he became a Black man and lived all the way through slavery times into current day. But he aged about a third of the rate of regular humans. So he had to reinvent himself every few years or so. But he was kind of minding his business. He grew up a conservative, kind of staying out of it, member of the original Grand Old Party. But he met a girl who tried to rob his house, and he stopped them using his powers. She convinced him to use his powers for good, and he started superheroing it up. He eventually, you know, kind of adjusted to the way that things were in the world and became a really good Superman level hero and is currently in the DC universe.
But, you know, first of all, I love that I hear your passion. I mean, you know, when I was coming up and my brothers were reading comic books and telling me all about it, I was over in a corner playing with my paper doll. So I know that I really missed out. I mean, I dibbled and dabbled, but I mean, after this, I need to go do some even more research, because now you have really just piqued my interest in this. So tell us about What Not Wednesdays. What is What Not Wednesdays?
Yeah, so there's a selling platform that's kind of been up and coming called Whatnot, where it gives you the ability to purchase collectibles, goods, everything from trading cards to video games to vintage clothing and movies, anything that you want. So their comic book channel has really been taken off. So it's given me the opportunity as a reseller to post my wares up there in a live streaming format. So I can live auction off comic books and interact with the community and sell goods in real time. So it's been awesome.
So if someone is interested in purchasing some of these, what are your cost points?
Yeah, I have things that are as cheap as $1 that range all the way up to $250 to $300, depending on what it is that you're looking for. That's the good thing about comic books. It's very, there's a low entry point if you're interested in learning and reading. But if you're more of a niche collector and you're looking for the most rare, the most exclusive, hard to find things, those things are out there.
You have me so excited. I absolutely love this. And I love even in the back how we can see on the wall that you have the covers of the different comic features back there. So I love that. So again, earlier you mentioned that you have another business, Quintessential Consulting. Can you tell us a little bit more, like who's your target audience for that business?
Yeah, so in my time in the military, I was a government contracting officer and an acquisition professional. So I purchased goods and services on behalf of the government to be used on military bases or in contingency operations, kind of all across the globe. So I always, interacted with small businesses, helping them, through their paying and purchasing and getting government contracts and serving the government. So when I left active duty and joined the professional world outside of government service, I kind of stayed in that realm in my work in, a government service contract provider and working in economic development. I always worked with in the business community. So when I started Quintessential Consulting, the goal was to take those skills that I've accumulated over the last 20 years and put them into action, helping businesses better refine their pitch or their approach to obtaining government contract work and positioning themselves in the best possible space to achieve their goals of serving new customers, serving clients, getting new partners, being grow up, blow up, being sold or purchased or acquired, or just becoming a household name, as you mentioned earlier.
Right. Well, I mean, again, what I love about you is that you are pursuing your passions with both of your businesses. I mean, we met through the Loudoun County Chamber of Commerce, and I mean, you have been so helpful to many of us small business owners, including myself. And I just love that you not only talk the talk, you walk the walk, and it is genuine and sincere. So thank you so much for that. My next question for you is, what has been some of your greatest challenges with becoming an entrepreneur?
Time is the great mystery. There's never enough hours in the day, because not only do I have a day job, I also have a family. I have a wife. I have children. So making those are my priorities. But I still want to pursue my passions because I'm human. So really finding enough time to do all of those things is challenging. But the challenge is the reward, as you have said yourself. The challenge is the reward, the ability to pursue my passions while maintaining a family, while supporting my children and supporting my wife, and I can still do the things that I enjoy doing. That gets me up in the morning. It really does.
I completely understand. What advice would you give to someone who has a day job and they're thinking about becoming an entrepreneur, stepping out on faith? What kind of advice would you give to them about becoming an entrepreneur?
I would say that number one, have a plan. Don't just jump into this world without having some kind of plan, or making sure that your skills are up to snuff. Not to, say that you're not skilled or qualified, but make sure that you can make it out here, because this is not a game for everybody. I want you to make sure that you know exactly what it is that you're stepping into. But also, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to step out here, because you have to have faith in yourself and in your abilities. You have made it this far in your life. You can do anything you set your mind to. Just make sure you got your mind right.
Oh my goodness, you just said a mouthful. I think it's so important to, you know, you have to be willing to invest in yourself, take that risk, step out on faith, because you just never know. You won't know unless you try, you know. So where can folks find more information about you for Killer Bee Comics and Quintessential Consulting?
Absolutely. You can find me on killerbcomics.com or at killerbcomics on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, whatnot. Kept it Killer Bee Comics all across those platforms. For Quintessential Consulting, you can find me at QCLLC.co, not .com, .co, but .co, right? But you can also find me on LinkedIn. You can find me on Facebook, Brandon Ferris. I'm very Googleable, very findable. Just seek me out.
Love that. And you know, when I first went to your website for Killer Bee Comics, what I loved, and I wrote this out because I wanted to do this little commercial for you. Killer Bee Comics is your one-stop shop to buy, sell, consign, and find all things comics. I love that. So if you need somebody to do your voiceover for your commercial, holla at me because I can help you with that. So, is there anything else you would like for our viewers to know before we leave?
Thank you, Tracy, number one, for the opportunity to share. You've always been supportive, always gracious, and I've been following you since I met you, and I like everything that I've seen, and I can't wait for the opportunity to see you in person again. And to everybody out there, pursue your passions. You know, time will always continue to count down. You can start when you're one, you can start when you're 21 or 51. It doesn't matter. Pursue your passions, pursue your goals. Do it when you can, while you can, and whoever telling you you can't, you don't need them.
Thank you so much for joining us today, Brandon, and sharing your story. Brandon Ferris, check him out. He's on all social media platforms, and we will absolutely see you again. Thank you so much. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back with Rob Zinn.
Are you ready on the Tracy Hamlin Show?
Debuting an icon number one in May of 1993, Raquel Irvin was born in the roughest neighborhood in Dakota City. She ran into Augustus Freeman IV when she tried to rob his house, discovering that he was an alien with superpowers. She convinced him to become the superhero icon, where she also became his sidekick wielding kinetic powers. She also became the first teen mom in comic book history, discovering she was pregnant shortly after becoming a superhero. That didn't stop her from doing her thing and becoming an integral part of Icon's story. She always was there, always had his back. Eventually, the Dakotaverse was pulled into the DC Universe where they clashed with the JLA, and yes, Rocket went up against Batman, and she won. DC recently reinvented Icon and Rocket, where Rocket is still a badass, still doing her thing.
Check me out at KillerBComics.com for all things comics.
I used to watch BET, MTV, VH1, now I watch Tempo, Soca, Calypso, Reggae Dancehall, don't stall, better get tuned in to the Tempo. Don't have cable, they got an app, go to your app store, download that. Whether it's tourism, cuisine, or the social scenes, if it ain't Tempo, it's a wrap. Who got the Caribbean views? Tempo. It's the latest in Caribbean news. Tempo. You tryna cook Caribbean food? Tempo. You know they got the music videos too. Tempo. Who got the Caribbean views? Tempo. It's the latest in Caribbean news. Tempo. You tryna cook Caribbean food? Tempo. You know they got the music videos too. Tempo.
Hey everybody, I'm Tracy Hamlin, and I'm so excited to share that I'm going to be coming your way every Monday night for an entire hour to spotlight some phenomenal unsigned artists from around the globe, as well as some amazing small businesses from my area that you need to know about. I'm also going to throw in a song or two. Something like that, a little something like that. Now, I'm gonna need you guys to tell all your friends, your cousins, your aunties, your bosses, come on in here and join us. We're gonna have so much fun. You don't want to miss this. I'll see you soon. Ooches of smooches.
Are you ready?
Tracy Hamlin Show.
On the Tracy Hamlin Show.
Tracy Hamlin Show.
Are you ready?
welcome back to the Tracy Hamlin Show. Again, this show is a platform for quality talent, and our next guest is very much that. He hails from the state of Maryland, now living in St. Pete, Florida, and he is an amazing trumpeter and flugelhornist. Please welcome to the show, Rob Zinn. Hey, Rob.
How you doing, Tracy?
How are you? And welcome, welcome, welcome. So good to see you.
Likewise. Yeah, we saw each other a couple months ago, but this is certainly a new experience, you know, looking through the TV, computers. Know, right? Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, so, you know, before we dig into the questions and talk about your journey, a lot of folks don't know what a flugelhorn is. So, do you have your flugelhorn nearby? Can you just show us what a flugelhorn looks like?
Check this out. This almost looks very new age, but it's...
Oh, I love
it. Yeah. And all that. Yeah. I love this horn. A lot of fun to play. And the flugelhorn is great for jazz. You know, this design is called a shepherd's crook here. Shepherd's hook. It's been around for decades, but, you know, not, you know this, Tracy, but for all the people out there listening now, performing is not just about what people hear, it's what they see. And it's very important to connect with people, not just. You know, sonically, but also visually. So every show I ever do, plus with my trumpet, I'm a Phaeton endorsed artist. So with my trumpet, people come and go, wow, what's that horn? That's really cool. And I get a lot of comments about this flugelhorn. And so.
You are absolutely right. I tell people all the time when folks come to concerts, they really hear with their eyes. So yeah. You really have to make sure that it's not only about a great performance, but visually it has to be appealing as well. So let's talk about your journey. Take us back to when you first got introduced to the trumpet.
All right. Well, I was when I was a little kid, I was always drumming on things and humming and just, you know, things like that. And my grandfather played trumpet and cornet in big bands way back in the day, 20s and 30s and all that. So I think my parents figured, well, you know, Bobby is what I was called back then, is going to play trumpet. So when I got into the fourth grade, you know, I asked for trumpet and I got that and, you know, played in, you know, the typical, you know, the concert bands. And then they had district jazz bands, which that was my first exposure to jazz. I made the district jazz band and then future all-state jazz band. And my high school had a very, very good jazz band. We competed all over the place. Mm-hmm. And but my musical journey sort of stops there. I did not go to college and major in music. My parents, while very supportive of my music, especially later on in my life. Mm-hmm. My father really dissuaded me from being a professional musician, so I did not pursue music in college, and I continued to play after college. In college, I was in the band. I toured Europe a few times with jazz bands, and always played, Tracy, just always played in all kinds of different kinds of bands, big bands, ska bands, funk bands, party band, wedding bands, blues bands, cut a couple albums, but it was always just a pastime. You know, I just loved music. And it was a great joy, but I also didn't even practice for like decades. You know, I was never moving my abilities forward because it was just a part-time job, not even a job, just a part-time passion. But about 5 years ago, I got real serious and said, oh, wow, I want to be a smooth jazz artist. What do I do? You know, how do I do that?
I did.
It was wild. So, you know, a lot of people helped me along the way. And I want to just say this flugelhorn. Mm-hmm. When I was young, I listened to Chuck Mangione. Now, a lot of guys, I kind of grew up listening to different kind of music, and I'm, you know, a big fan of like Chet Baker and Lee Morgan, Dizzy Gillespie, Miles Davis, you know, well represented right here. Mm-hmm. But Mangione was a unique artist in that he transcended jazz into pop in this song called Feel So Good, which, you know, he made very, very popular with an instrument just like this. Mm-hmm. And he crossed over and became extremely popular with Feel So Good. So I actually play that at my shows and it gets a great reaction.
Well, I love that you've played all of these different genres. And I know that you have two CDs out with a third that it's well on the way. So it sounds like even though you've done all these genres, you always came back to jazz. So is that your favorite genre?
It really is, you know, and you can really express yourself so many different ways. There's only so many if you want to play correctly, if you're playing a funk solo or anything like that, or an R&B solo, you have to play within the parameters of that genre. So you can't really go way outside. Jazz is like an open slate. And this is what's really cool about, you know, certainly from, I'm going to speak from a horn player's perspective. You know, I can paint that palette any way I want. Now, there are certain restrictions, as you know, and maybe just for the audience, you know, you want to be real careful. But for the most part, you don't want to be playing bebop type stuff, you know, Dizzy Gillespie type lines, or, you know, during a smooth jazz contemporary solo. It's more popish, but you can really express yourself. And I really enjoy that. And you know what's really cool? Every performance is different. I mean, there's certain things, you know, I might go to that I like, is sustaining a note, whatever. But pretty much every solo is different. They just really are. There's no cookie cutter approach to it. And I love that latitude and that freedom and flexibility. It's awesome.
Yeah, I think that it's so great to be connected to a lot of different genres. I know for me, it's been a blessing and a curse, because I love that I'm versatile, but record labels, they kind of want to pigeonhole you, you know? So it's like, they don't care that you're versatile. They want you to decide what you want to be and stay in that lane. And that is why I started my own label, because when I couldn't get a deal, record labels were saying, oh, well, what does she want to be? And I said, I'm not trying to be anything. I'm a singer that can deliver whatever is called for.
Of course. You know?
But all of those genres that I grew up listening to have greatly influenced the singer that I've become. So I know with you, you've played lots of bands and you've opened for Cool in the Gang and Tower of Power and the Average White Band. Is there a favorite? Do you have a favorite?
You know, when I was, I'm probably going to date myself a little bit, but I've just love Tower of Power. I mean, just so much. I mean, I'm a trumpet player, 5-piece horn section, and they're still funking it up today. It's so amazing. So much respect for those guys. You know, the style of music, the creativity, you know, they created something that had never really been done before. So it was a real thrill to open up for them. They didn't know who I was. It was just a local funk band, but it was a big venue. There were thousands of people there. And I actually really enjoyed opening for Cool and the Gang. I had they were on the pop side, but, you know, R&B, soul, funk a little bit. And it was a real thrill.
Yeah, a lot of energy. So I saw that you performed in Mallorca. That is one of the destinations that I would love to go to, especially go to and perform. What was that experience like? Was that your first time performing outside of the States?
In this genre, yes, it was. You know, for myself, it was. Mm-hmm. What Christian's doing over in Mallorca, and he also has a festival in Algarve, the fans are, they come from like 25 different countries all over. It's top of the notch. It's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. The engineering is perfect. The venues are amazing. The musicianship is great. It was so much fun. Not only did I have my own show, but I also jumped on stage with Reagan Whiteside, and that's the first time I met her and Dennis Johnson, which led to something hopefully I can talk about later. I played with Kelly Minucci. He's like, hey, Rob, come up and play with me. I played with DW3, and it was just – and I had, like I said, I had my own show. So it's surreal. It's just so much fun, and the audience just loved the musical offerings that everyone was giving, and I just had a great time. You really felt like a star. But what was really cool about Mallorca is – we had dinner with everyone. So it was so much fun for me. People would come up and like, you know, we don't want to disturb you during dinner, but, you know, can we get a picture and can we get our autograph? And I just thought that was so cool. That some people were hesitant, but I'm like, to me, that's what it's about, that connection. And I loved it. It was great.
It's nothing like that connection to be out and meet your fans and chat with them and find out what they like and why they like, you know, the different songs that you do. So, you work with Reagan, and you have the single that you have out with Reagan. What is that one called?
It's called Push It Forward. And like I said, when I actually met Reagan and Dennis in Mallorca, and I jumped up on one song, Jeff Ryan and I did. We provided the horn, backing horn for her one song, which, it's escaping me right now. I apologize, Reagan. I can't remember the name of the song. It'll probably come to me later, but it was a lot of fun. So I met them and, you know, and we developed a friendship. We were hanging backstage with Peter White, listening to his stories, because he went on later that night, you know, the great Peter White. And it was just a lot of fun. You know, Tracy, those backroom hangs are really fun. The green room experiences are really, really fun, where you get to really meet people.
Absolutely.
So great. And they reached out and said, we would like to, you know, do a song with you. And the rest, as they say, is history. So Push It Forward is now out and available everywhere. So I'm really excited with that single.
Wow, that is a great story. Thank you for sharing. We are going to take a short break, and we will be right back with more from Rob Zen. I have lots of questions for you. We'll be right back.
Let's go. And that's why tempo is so, you know, so important and sort of on point, because there's a tempo to everything that we do in the Caribbean. You know what I'm saying? It's a hard beat.
We have a whole channel, man. The Caribbean is so diverse.
And for them to recognize that and to launch a channel for that, that is totally amazing.
I started to think about all of that, and I was like, wow. I said, well, wait a minute. These are all the things that make great television.
Watch on Tempo YouTube.
And welcome back to the Tracy Hamlin Show. We are chatting it up with Rob Zinn. Rob, we just saw a video of your song, Take That. Can you tell us a little bit about that and who was the maestro on keys?
I'd love to. Thank you, Tracy. That's a song that Greg Manning and I cooked up, right before COVID. I recorded it in Michael's Parlor Studio out in somewhere out in California. I can't remember exactly where. Really great experience, amazing studio. And Greg is, I don't know if you know him or not, he's such a gentleman, such a nice guy, and absolutely amazingly, incredibly talented on not just the keyboard, but also as a producer and composer. So yeah. It's really cool to collaborate with him. I had so much fun. And that video I shot around Delaware, I wanted to kind of, I don't know, give a little bit of homage to Delaware. My first video, I shoot them at different places. They all mean something quite a bit to me. So I really wanted to showcase some places in Delaware that were meaningful to me, as well as, my friends and family back from Delaware, you know, because I knew I was going to be departing. And it was just really important to me to kind of showcase little old Delaware. So that's what I did.
Oh, it's a great video. I love the song. I just, you know, when I listen to it, I just really, really just get consumed. Absolutely love it. And Greg Manning, you're right. I mean, I have not met him personally, but I'm well aware of his music, and we have a ton of mutual friends, and everybody speaks so highly of him. So question for you. So when you record versus performing live, is there a different process that you have with preparation and warming up, or performing versus recording? What do you do differently, or is it the same?
No, I warm up pretty much the same way, and everyone has their own technique that works for them. I warm up the same way, whether I'm doing a live show or in my studio. You just really want to, you know, like yourself, your vocal cords are your instrument. You know, my lips are my instrument. So you want to make sure that there's proper moisture. I mean, I don't know how exciting this is, but it's, you know, just make sure my lips are warmed up and limber. And also you want to, for the tone of the horn and the intonation, you know, make sure it sounds in tune. It has to be a certain warmth and moisture in it. So if you just pick your horn up and play it, more than likely it's going to be out of tune. And so, it just goes through 15 minutes or so.
But you brought up a great point. I mean, when we see instrumentalists, whether it's a saxophone player or a flute player, I mean, nobody really talks about what you guys do. And this could be a crazy question, but do you wear chapstick? Do you make sure you have water? Like, what kind of exercises do you do to make sure that, you know, things feel warmed up?
Oh, absolutely. I baby my lips, and I live in Florida now, so I don't have those really cold winters, but I have this, it's actually called a chop saver. It literally says chop saver, and it's got all this great stuff for my lips. And if I play a lot one day, it'll get really raw. So I pretty much have versions of that all over my cars and, you know, in my house all over the place. And I use it religiously. I have to.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So are you warmed up now? Can you play a little something for us on the beautiful flugelhorn that's in your hand?
Well, I'm not warmed up, so hopefully I won't make any too many mistakes. But this is really fun. I get such a kick out of this. I mentioned this a little bit before. about Chuck Mangione. I think he's really important for our genre because he started some things back in a long time ago in the 70s, had great music, great composition, didn't always get credit for being a great player, but this song was transcendental. It went from jazz to pop and was a massively huge hit for him. And I love to play this song at my shows because what happens, and I get a huge kick out of this, when I start to play like the first three or four notes, people recognize the song, and then usually they burst out clapping because, like, oh, they all know the song. They recognize it, and it takes them back to, whenever they were first exposed to the song. So I'm not going to play into the mic because, trumpets can be loud. So we did play on flugelhorn, so here we go.
Okay.
It's called Feel So Good.
Feel So Good. I know that song very, very well. Loved it, loved it, loved it. I played in many of bands that, that was one of the first or second songs that we played at the beginning of the night. So, thank you.
It's not an easy song. Chuck needs a lot. He gets a lot of credit for it. It's a hard song. And you mentioned the lip stuff, but there's nothing like, and you know this, Tracy, but for the fans and the people who are listening, you're a TV audience. You're standing and you're getting ready to play, and this is what we call like a cappella. So I'm playing by myself and a guitar is accompanying me. Okay. But I tell you, it's a lot of pressure, and you just got to relax, and you've done it a long time. You just relax and be yourself, and everything else is fine.
And especially when you're doing songs that people are familiar with, you don't know how you're going to be judged or if they can just sit back and relax and enjoy it or not. So, and like you said, it's a difficult song. So,
it really is. I'm like,
you have to be mindful of where you even place it in your set. So earlier you mentioned the brand that you endorse. A lot of folks don't understand about musicians endorsing different brands. So can you share the name of the brand again and tell us exactly what it is to endorse a brand?
Yeah, when I first embarked on becoming a national artist, whatever that means. I went out to NAMM, and that's a big music convention, massively huge, 100,000 people. So I went out there and was experiencing what it's like to be part of that. And there are companies, every company is represented, rock, just every genre of music. And it's kind of a who's who of musicians out there as well as performers. So the company I'm endorsed by is called Fate and Trumpets. And I would never just endorse a horn just to be have an endorsed horn or be on their print ads or any of that kind of stuff. I love the horn. I play the horn to this day. It looks really cool. It gives me the kind of sound that I want. And I've, like guitar players and sax players, we try all kinds of different instruments. So I play that just at my jazz shows. And it just gives me the tone that I'm looking for with contemporary jazz.
Well, you know what? I love your tone. Your first record, that came out in 2016. My favorite song from your first record is called Close Your Eyes. So guys, Google it, buy it. It's just a feel good song. It's a song that gives me goosebumps and I just love listening to it. So can you tell us a little bit about that song?
There's a friend of mine from high school, and he was a very successful musician, toured the world with all kinds of people, real famous people. And then he went on to be a producer. Mm-hmm. And he wrote a lot of songs for daytime TV. So I reached out to him. His name is Steve Hopkins. And we go way back, or even toured Europe together back in the day. So I was like, Steve, help me with this process. I'm not a music major. I've never written songs, but I felt I could do melodies. So he actually gave me a couple songs for the album, and that was one of them. And the interesting one thing that Tracy didn't mention on this is it's an EDM song, and it's really cool. And I just loved playing it. I was a fan of that music, but it's like one of these doesn't sound like the others, and it's Close Your Eyes. But, oh, it's such a cool song.
But it fits. It really works. It's such a cool song. It really, really is.
I love to play different styles of music. I don't want to be pigeonholed into any one particular thing. If you listen to what Rob's in now, you get a little bit of blues, a little bit of pop, a little bit of funk, a little bit of R&B and soul, some vocals maybe. I've got two covers coming up on my next album. I like to do a little bit everything. And I don't know if that hurts or helps me, but that's who I am as an artist.
you have to be authentically you. And that's what you're doing. So thank you very much.
You're wrong if I'm me.
Well, listen, I told you that our time together would fly by. So before we head out, can you just quickly tell us what your socials are so that people can stay in touch, see you live, and check out your next album when it comes out?
Yes, indeed. Well, the best place to catch all, get all my information about Rob Zinn, anything Rob Zinn, is just go to robzinn.com. That's one B and two N's, robzinn.com. And you can find me, Rob Zinn Music, on Facebook and all that. But Tracy, I do want to say one thing, because this is very important to me. I'm going to try to squeeze this in. I have a little bit of time. I do want to do a couple brief shout outs, if you will. I want to shout out to my son, Michael and Kyle.
Okay.
I'm very proud of you guys. And you know how much I love you. And Maureen for sticking up and being there with me on this journey. It's really fun to share this ride with someone. And my manager, Gina McCain, Major Scale Management, you know, we started kind of together on this, and it's been really a fun ride to share this stuff together. So Gina McCain, thank you very much for everything you do. And of course, most importantly for this particular moment is you, Tracy. Thank you so much for asking me to be on the show. And of course, iMovie Network, I'm honored and flattered to be on the show. So thank you all very much. And go to robzinn.com and you can find out what I'm doing.
And thank you, Rob, so much for joining us today. It has been an absolute pleasure. We hope to see you soon. Check him out on his socials. Tracy Hamlin. I'm Dorothy Marie Hamlin's baby girl, signing off. Thank you all so much for joining us. Ooches of smooches, and we'll see you next week, 7 p.m. right here on our TV network. Have a great week.
Bye, everyone.
Welcome back to the show. I'm your host, Randy Dennis. Our next performer, in our opinion, is one of the most exciting in our industry. She's just back from her world tour, and she is something else. Here to perform her latest hit, Stand By, on the DMH record label. Put your hands together, gang, for Tracy Hamlin.
Can't keep.